Welcome to Freedom Deal, the story of Lucky. I'm Jason Rosette, and my nickname is Jack in Cambodia. And then we've changed my last name to Roe. Jack Roe. This sets the background of the tale. This movie, the short, it's 26 minutes, 25. It's based on a feature screenplay. The feature, it's based on a section of the feature. The feature obviously has more time to develop the backstory and what's going on. The short just doesn't. So the title role explains a lot of the details that will help the non-Cambophiles understand it. God, I worked pretty hard to make it as short as possible, but there really was no way to get rid of it. And there's a quick glimpse of the Arb. Cambodian floating head, vampiric female ghost. Actually, the Arb is related regionally to the Krasu in Thailand and in Malaysia, the, God, how is it pronounced? Ringgalit? Anyway. So this is the story of Lucky. Basically, I wanted to tell a story from the point of view of the local people, the perspective of the people who would be encountering the growing conflict on their in their country. At the time, in 1970, Cambodia was, well, it was neutral. It was always neutral. But in 1970, April 30th, that's when the Cambodian incursion was formally launched to by U.S. and Army of South Vietnam forces entered Cambodia with organized, mechanized units to seek out and destroy weapons caches, North Vietnamese and Viet Cong weapons caches and so forth. They had been long infiltrating Cambodia, and the states really, and South Vietnam, there was nothing they could do until the formal orders were given to move in mechanized units. Anyway, but I wanted to tell it from the point of view of two regular country folk who are caught up in this swirling conflict behind them. And May 4th is the inciting date. Now, given the time difference, May 4th in Cambodia would be, the story takes place in the afternoon, say. Let's say it's 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the afternoon. That would be 2 a.m. on May 4th in Ohio. And I chose that because of the, well, I wanted to intersect with the Kent State incidents in Ohio because the Kent State protesters were, that protest was incited by the, amongst other things, the Cambodian incursion. That's what they were protesting when Nixon announced what they perceived to be an expansion of the war. And what many perceived to be an expansion of the war, protests began. Protesters and non-protesting students were shot, and so I wanted to link this because most people know about the Kent State incidents, but what was happening in Cambodia? What was happening on the ground in Asia? And that's what, that was the premise. That was the what if that launched this story. Shot entirely in Cambodia with some, as you can see, archival footage, stock footage. And our friendly ghost. Actually, not so friendly. The Arb traditionally does not appear during the daytime, but I needed to introduce the Arb for a moment so the viewer did not forget about the Arb. Otherwise, her appearance later is too strange or comes out of the blue. So here's the Lonol commander, Sok Sochit, who also is the owner of the Jeep. He was he was actually brought on just for the Jeep, and the guy who's sitting in the driver's side, he was supposed to be the driver. He was supposed to be the commander. But as we had the Jeep just for a day, and as we were rehearsing and setting up the shots, the guy kept blowing his lines. And meanwhile, I noticed Sochit remembered the lines very well. So we really needed to start shooting. And I just, at one point, I said, hey, okay, you guys switch clothes, switch wardrobe, switch clothes. So, Chi, you're the commander now. And it's true, I've shown this movie in its form. The Cambodian people, actual Cambodians in Cambodia, find it to be quite authentic. I showed it to a colleague of mine who was a Lanol. He was in Lanol's army before, of course, Khmer Rouge defeated them and took over the country. So, and he looked at the movie and said, yeah, it was generally authentic. And most Cambodians really, well, every Cambodian person I've shown it to really is pleased to watch it. And the thing is that very few Cambodians, the older generation remembers, but the youth, they don't, none of them know, really, that a few of them realize that there was this, there were six armies fighting in Cambodia at that one point. Few of them realize their country's, the fact that they were dragged into this conflict in some way. And although it's sort of fashionable to say that the Cambodian incursion helped precipitate Cambodia's fall into the clutches of the Khmer Rouge, that's not true. I mean, most of the studies I've read, I did a lot of research for this movie, including Cambodian scholars, including, for example, Sok Sutsakan, General, Lieutenant General of the Khmer of Lanol's army and the Khmer Republic at the end. He tells in great detail about what was going on in Cambodia before the incursion. There you can see U.S. soldiers pulling weapons out of the ground. That basically once the port of Sihanoukville was closed to Vietnamese war materials, the Vietnamese communists, they absolutely needed to have the Ho Chi Minh Trail open. It was their only way to get supplies down to South Vietnam to continue their fight, so they moved inland with mechanized units into Cambodia long before the U.S., before the Cambodian incursion took place. And they were within 25 miles of Phnom Penh, and Cambodia was in real danger of collapsing, actually, and becoming a province of North Vietnam. Anyway, the two actors, there's Paul In Sok, the musician, and Darit, Kun Darit. We did an open casting call in the Cambodian Daily. Thanks very much. The Cambodian Daily graciously allowed us to place an ad, helped us with indie-level advertising. Our budget was super low on this movie. In fact, every bit of equipment except the editing machine was sold off to continue editing and finishing and so forth while I was in Cambodia, actually. Right now I'm in Yangon. I'm in Rangoon, Myanmar, a.k.a. Burma, as I read this. But those two actors, open casting calls don't really, they don't really go down too well in Cambodia. It's a totally different system there. It's not really a developed industry like we have here. I lived in Cambodia, lived and worked there more than 6 years. And most things are done by word of mouth. But luckily, Paulin, he showed up to the open call, and he is a teacher at Royal University of Fine Arts and happened to have done some acting in some NGO movies and spots. And one of his students is Darit here, who really was, I think, did a remarkable job considering the limitations of the shoot. So there's one of our frog actors. We had six frogs in total for this movie. We had two live frogs as actors. Both were released to their freedom in the countryside. Actually, one broke free. But just after we had finished our last shot, two partly steamed frogs, steamed enough so that the actors could nibble on them without it being absolutely disgusting to them. And two completely raw frogs, dead. But we didn't kill them. The market lady had killed them for us. And animal rights people, I guess you'd be happy to know, the frogs were killed anyway, so it's not like they killed them especially for us. And, you know, so there he is. That frog is still alive. And actually, that frog, he escaped shortly after that shot. He looks dead, but he's not. He's playing dead. You can faintly see a little string somewhere in there holding him. And one observation some people have made, they said, well, why if they're traveling so far, why aren't they caked with more mud? Oh, there is the Arb appearing for the first time. And the Arb is played by Aran Lun, a colleague of ours with a related effort. We do a movie festival in Cambodia called Cambo Fest, and she stepped in to play the Arb. She's actually very enchanting in real life. What was I going to say? Yeah, so in the story, they're actually, and it's related in the backstory when they're talking to the Lanal soldier, commander. They were playing at a wedding earlier in the morning, and then suddenly something happened, a bomb. In the reality, quote-unquote, of the story, it was a B-52 strike. That's in the feature version. However, the backstory was constructed in that scene to explain that they had been at a wedding earlier, so that's why, and they've only been hiking for a few hours, walking. So they haven't, first of all, they're wearing, you know, the best clothes that rural people might have, and secondly, it hasn't been that long in the story. However, I agree, a movie should stand on its own. So, and here, interestingly, in the script, the script says those foreigners were in Vietnam. When he's referring to the French involvement in Vietnam, the actor here, on his own, he called them, and I didn't realize this until we were editing, he called them colonialists. So on his own, unpromptedly, he called them colonialists. I decided in the first rough cut, I said, well, I'm going to subtitle it word for word, just what he said. Then I realized, well, you know, my agreement with the Cambodian film office, they approved the script as it stood, and I should stick to the script that I provided to them to approve. Cambodian film department, part of the Ministry of Culture, Fine Art, has to approve every script that gets made. They like this script, actually. There was no problem with it at all. It's a story about two ordinary people who are caught up in an extraordinary situation. And nothing like it had been done, or has been done, actually. This is as modest as it is. It's the first ever on-screen dramatization of what may have been taking place during the Cambodia incursion. And you have Western armies coming into Cambodia. It's meeting with, for the first time, with there's an Asian-Western intersection that takes place that's never been explored on screen. And that's what I thought to be really fascinating, too. So this is that little clip there where he's running, it's not actually Darit. That was the actor from a demo we shot before, a scene demo, as a fundraiser. And that's the only remaining shot from the scene demo, but it really works there. And he was a great actor, too, that kid from the scene demo. Which was shot down in Kampot, up on, if you look closely again, next time or whatever, it was shot on top of Bokor Mountain. The trochmai here, that's the name of the instrument. The traditional instrument is called the trochmai. It's cracked because, well, in the story, in the feature story, it was damaged during the B-52 strike. For the short version, I just left it in as a textural item. But for those people who may be curious, that's why it was cracked. And if you're wondering, Polin actually does not play Troc Khmer. The Troc Khmer actual playing is done by a fellow in Takeo province. And initially, Polin, he was quite reluctant to pretend to play Troc Khmer, but then once we had to cast him. He was so good as the character. He was the only one, and we said, look, you've got to talk to your Troc Khmer playing friends, which he did, and they gave him little lessons, and he became sort of passable at it. So, something foreboding about to happen, but I don't want to spoil it for you. This location was found. This was our second location, actually. The first location was washed out by a rain, unexpected rain. It just was too muddy and flooded when we got there. We found this one on the day of the shoot, actually. The leg is a bone of a cow, a real bone of a cow, and his leg is tucked into a hole and surrounded with the bone and some meat and ligaments and stuff, and it looks pretty authentic. The Lanol fellow, Mr. Khan, who runs the vintage cinema house in Kampot, for those CamboFest aficionados who may have been there, he was, again, in the Lanol army. When he first saw the mine explosion, first of all, he steps on a mine, as you can see. In the story, it's planted by Khmer Rouge, Khmer Graham, and Mr. Khan wondered, well, why isn't the explosion bigger? It would have taken off his whole leg. And we said, well, no, because we'd researched it, and I looked at a lot of mine wounds and injuries to get that right. And I estimated it would be an anti-personnel mine, 250 grams of TNT. Bikam ganla, that's Bikam ganla in Khmer, 200 grams and a half and 50. Bikam ganla. And Mr. Gon, he nodded. He said, oh, yeah, of course. Yes, that would be an anti-personnel mine. And that's what it was. Here comes the ghost. The op. All of this was shot day for night, by the way. The op was shot on a green screen, which we manufactured in my apartment in Phnom Penh. And the textures were created by Martin. Sorry, Martin. In Canada. The guts of the ob, Michael Martin, okay, the guts of the ob, those are the guts of a pig that Rata, our great colleague, he was sound man, translator and assistant, whatnot. Or was it Tall? It was Tall. It was Mr. Tall. He arranged to get the pig guts from a butcher lady. And the pig guts were used just for an hour, so we kept them in my refrigerator, and they're meant to be eaten, made into soup and stews and stuff. Kept them in the fridge, perfect condition. Took them out, used them for an hour in the shoot. The only interference, the only changes we made to it were to add this fake blood, which is just corn syrup with dye. Put it back in the refrigerator. And then the next day, Mr. Tall, he took it to his army base, because Tall is also, his Navy base. He works with the Navy in Cambodia. And they ate it. he gave it to the mess hall at the Navy, and they ate. So those guts that you see in the movie were all eaten. Not the cow bone that was tossed aside. By the end of the shoot, it was so hot when we were shooting. And we were there a few days on that location, so it really started to smell after a while. This was not conceived of as any kind of symbolic type thing, the covering of leaves. It was strictly an instinctive, well, it was devised, you know, previously in the script, but in terms of the character, it's not like he's symbolically trying to do anything. He's just according to his instinct, that's all he can think of to do, is to cover him with these bits of plant foliage. And then, of course, stumbles across the Tro Khmer, which has been forgotten in the incident, in the chaos of his mentor, his friend, having had his leg blown off. They're actually not long-term buddies. They, in the story, in the feature version, I mean, this would occur about halfway through the movie, or 60% of the way through the movie. Again, they knew each other. They met. He was the musician at the wedding, and Dorit was one lucky Samnang, in Cambodian, was one of the village people at the wedding, and they just stumbled upon each other in the aftermath. So you can see him moving slightly there. He gave a nice textured performance here. It was one of the challenging things with emerging talent in Asia, and it's just a different mindset. It's just a different perspective. It's not worse. It's not better. Whatever. There can be a tendency to overact, you know, to play it up to the camera, and that is actually, it's a style. It's a convention that works a lot for some of their TV and so forth. In this case, obviously, I couldn't have him playing it up, and he. It did take a few takes here and there, a few extra takes, but he was able to tone it down in a very nice way. Oh, the music. Yes, the score by the incredibly talented Mi-Hun Kim, who I didn't actually meet yet. We worked online. I was in Cambodia, and she was in L.A. She still is working with USC, or is it UCLA? Composition school, and we worked sending clips and bits and, you know, instructions online back and forth. She came up with some amazing stuff. I mean, the score is like another character. So all of the details of the cast and crew and making of the movie are on the website too. So anyone who's interested beyond this cursory director commentary, go to the website www.freedomdealmovie.com. And check it out. There's press kits there, trailers. Alec Chesky very generously helped us get this movie off the ground. And thank you for watching. It was a Camerato production. Okay.